chapter 21, verses 4 and 5, because it has a promise that God will wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, these words are true and faithful. So I really love these promises in the Bible. I feel like this is what strengthens my faith and hope, that God has a better plan, much better plan. And so the way I'm understanding this is a big reason why God allowed sin is because there will be a greater happiness, joy, and satisfaction after sin is all gone. Sin will teach all creation never to sin again. And never will the creation desire sin and pain again. So after the day of judgment, the universe will be secure against any future rise of sin and rebellion. Yes, pain and death will soon be a thing of the past. We will not be disappointed with the final results of the sin problem. We will rejoice together with God as we get victory over sin and death. And one of the texts that really are supportive of this is an Old Testament book, a tiny two or three chapter book called Nahum, N-A-H-U-M, Nahum. Chapter 1, verse 9, it says, What do you imagine against the Lord? He will make an utter end. Affliction, suffering, trouble, and sin will not rise up the second time. It will not rise up the second time. And so as I think about it, you know, there's always the potential with freedom of choice. There's always the potential for a person to say, no, I'm going to do it a different way, my own way. And so God has allowed everybody to have that opportunity in the beginning of the creation of the universe. Instead of the midway or toward the end, right at the very beginning, God wants to get this done and out of the way. He wants to allow people to say no, allow people to do alternative lifestyles, allow people to sin, so that when it's done, it will be forever done. People will never go back to that. We've been there and done that, we want no more to do with it. We don't want to suffer like that anymore. And so God is allowing this sin problem as a temporary thing. And because when it's over with, this creation will never want to ever go back to that again. So often our knowledge is based on circumstantial or partial evidence. For example, the Bible does not always give all the details or a complete picture in every story. So sometimes it's easy to get a wrong impression, a misinterpretation of the character of God in certain areas. So we pray to understand the beauty of God's character as revealed in the life of Jesus Christ. So we see that Jesus is the best mirror of the Father's heart, of the Father's character. You know, Ellen White wrote a book called Mind, Character, and Personality. It's actually a compilation of different supporting documents on those particular, on that theme. And Ellen White talked a lot about mind, character, and personality in the context of how important it is to reflect the character of Christ and the character of God. And if there was one statement we could say about God, what would it be? You know, I think of 1 John 4:8 as a defining aspect of God. He says, He that does not know does not know God. Why? For God is love. So God is that's essentially His character. He's a very loving person. And that's hard for us to understand. I mean, we don't live in a world of love, surrounded completely by love. I mean, there's love here a little bit. There's also a lot of hate, jealousy, cruelty. We think of the ISIS. We think of the unjust laws, the unjust systems that we live in today. And it makes us question, where is God in a world like this? But God has allowed it to be this way, this temporary situation, to prove our character mainly. So the way I like to think about it is, the end will be better than the beginning. And Jesus, you know, he performed his first miracle that wedding, and he changed the water into wine, or grape juice. And when the governor and the people tasted the water that was made wine, they got very excited. They said, this is very different. They always set out the best wine first, and then that which is worse toward the end. But you have saved the best until last. That was shockingly different. And that's the way God is. He saves the best for last. So we're just getting started. We've got a whole lot better to experience. We have a lot to look forward to. That's just the principle of the way God is. He gives us the best last. So it gets better as we go to the next phase. The earth made new will be better than the original Garden of Eden. There will be no more tree of evil. We have many examples of this in the Bible. Here's a text in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 1. A good name or reputation is better than precious ointment for like a perfume, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. I think of it like an apple tree is better than one apple seed, or the mature man or woman of God is better than an unknowing baby. So just saying that the end will be better than the beginning. And we have this promise in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end, a future and a hope. So all these things are telling us that there will be a happy ending to the story of redemption. And I always like a book or a movie better if it has a happy ending. So why do we have to feel pain? And I like to consider Job's story. You know, Job was considered a very successful businessman. He was like the billionaire of his day. He had it all, like the Bill Gates of his day. But he was a man of God, faith and prayer. He prayed for his children every day. He took care of the stranger. He made sure that people had clothes to wear and food to eat in the neighborhood. He was looking out for people who needed help. He was considered a good, righteous man, an example, a model type of person. And there was a heavenly council meeting at this time. And in those days, Satan was able to join the heavenly council meetings and give his advice and opinions. Now, after the death of Christ, he is no longer given that privilege. The angels will not let him join anymore. When they saw what he did to Jesus Christ, they saw how evil he really was. They don't allow him in anymore. But back in those days, they thought they had a different feeling for Lucifer. They thought he had a point, and they didn't see how bad sin really was. And they thought human beings deserved what we got because we could never keep the law anyway. So it's okay if we get tortured and killed and suffered. But when it came to their own beloved commander who did no sin, that was just too much. That broke that tie of sympathy. He's no longer allowed in the council meetings, but back in these days he was. So God acknowledges him, Satan, says, how are you doing? Where did you come from? He says, well, I came from the earth. I'm the representative there. The earth is mine. And I'm the proud ruler of earth. And so, you know, the Lord here, Jesus, is saying, well, have you considered my servant Job? This is like a slap in the face, an insult. Have you considered how good Job is? He's a righteous man. He hates evil. That was something that Satan just couldn't stomach very well. Got a little comfort. He says, yeah, well, you know, there's a reason for that. It's because you put a hedge of protection around him and all that he has, and that's, he's living a good life, and that's why he served you. But if you take all that away, he's going to curse you to your face. So there we have it, a challenge. Now, did Job know what was going on? At that time, he did. So this is going on above Job. He didn't know what they were talking about. So Jesus gave him permission. Okay, I'm going to let you do what you want to Job's property and his stuff, but just don't touch his life. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. And did he get busy? In one day, what happened? Chapter 1, Job chapter 1. One messenger after another. Well, an enemy army came and took away your herds and flocks and killed all your hirelings, and I'm the only one that escaped alive to tell you about it. And right after him, here come another messenger. That the fire of God came down from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants. I'm the only one left to come and tell you about it. And all his livestock, all his animal herds, all his billions of dollars worth went down in a day. And then, as if that wasn't bad enough, another messenger came and said, your sons and daughters are eating and drinking and having a festival in the house, and a big hurricane, like a typhoon, a big wind came and blew the house, and they're all dead. And so he lost it all in a day. And then the next day, seemed like they had another heavenly council meeting, and Satan comes up there to represent planet Earth, and again the Lord addresses him. Well, you know, Job is still serving me, even though you caused me to allow us all that to happen to him. And Satan was a little uncomfortable with that, you know. Well, you know, there's still one thing. He said, skin for skin. A man will do anything for his life. He said, if you harm this person, he will curse you to your face. I'm sure he will this time. Any man will curse you to your face if you hurt his person, you know, if you damage him personally. So again, the Lord's going to give him permission. He said, okay, I'm going to let you give him some suffering, some hardship, some personal issues, but just don't kill him. You can't kill him. What do you think Satan did? He gave him the worst case of disease. He gave him boils from the top of his head, the crown of his head, to the sole of his feet. Boils all over his body. Painful. Boils. And it says that Job sat down in the ashes and took a piece of pottery, scraping those boils in pain and itchy, swollen and sore. Miserable. I've had poison ivy many times. I've had to take steroids for it. I've had to take different creams and stuff for it. I've suffered with the itch and the discomfort of poison ivy. And but anyway, yeah. So what did Job's wife tell him to do? You know, she was fed up. I mean, this was affecting her. This was her money that went down in the day. This was her family that died in the typhoon or her tornado. And so she tells Job, just curse God and die. And did Job follow that advice? He did. He said, do you speak like a foolish woman? He says, we came into this world naked and without nothing, and when we die, we can't take anything with us. He said, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It says, in all this, Job did not sin. And so Satan lost the battle, and Jesus won the battle because his servant was faithful, and we can be faithful too. That's a challenge for us, isn't it? When we hit those mountains of obstacles, when we hit those problems, if we can maintain our faith in God, that honors God, that gives us a rich heavenly reward, and it defeats the enemy. Job was allowed to speak what was in his heart. And although he remained faithful to God, he cursed the day of his birth. It would be better that I had never been born. that was just his worst nightmare. He said, the thing that I greatly feared and was afraid of came upon me. This is what I didn't want to have happen. I didn't want my family to die, my sons and daughters. I didn't want all this to happen. He says, I've been a good man. And you can read chapter after chapter after chapter, 40 chapters in the book of Job. How Job said, I fed the hungry, I clothed the naked, I helped people out, and I stayed faithful to my wife. Why, God, why? And what did his friends tell him? Job, God does not punish good people. This could never happen to you unless you have a secret sin in your life. Confess it. Only the wicked suffer like this. So on and on the arguments went. Until the time came when the Lord appeared to Job in a personal way. It probably wasn't exactly the way Jesus appeared to Saul on the road to Damascus. But Job had an encounter with God. And when Job saw God, he said, I repent, and sackcloth and ashes. I abhor myself. It was overwhelmed with the glory of God. And so the Lord began asking all these questions, and Job didn't feel like he had a satisfactory answer to those. So Job just accepted the lecture. And the Lord told Job that your friends did not speak the thing that was right about me, about who my character, who I am. And so I want you to pray for him. So Job prayed for his friends that God would forgive him and heal him. And then God turned the captivity of Job. And it was all turned around again. And God blessed Job's life. And he got twice as much as he had before. Twice as much wealth, twice as many herds, twice as much sheep and camels and oxen. And he had sons and daughters. He had it all. He was probably one of the wealthiest men of his time. And God greatly enriched and blessed his life. And I think that Job's latter end, he understood why it happened like that. Why do I have to feel pain? He understood that. There was a purpose in that. It wasn't for nothing. It wasn't because God said, I'm just going to pick on you and cause you a bunch of suffering and laugh at you. It wasn't like that at all. God had a distinct purpose and reason for allowing that pain and affliction and suffering to come to Job. And Job understood it, and he accepted it, and he was okay with it. And his latter end was better than the beginning. And so it will be with us. So it will be with Jesus Christ. We think of Christ going to the cross, suffering and dying, tortured, beaten, whipped, and all of that, bleeding. And we think, that just can't be real. You know, God would not allow himself to suffer like that. But when we see the latter end, when we see Philippians chapter 2, God has given Jesus a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, the glory of God the Father. When we see Christ winning us, weaning us away from the evil of sin, helping us to die a spiritual death to sin, and being reborn again as God's new creation, a new creature in Christ. Old things are passed away. All things are become new. And you see the multitude of the saved, we're going to rejoice. We're going to praise God. And we're going to see that God has a good reason for all these things that at this time we don't fully understand. But we can trust God. I've read enough and understood enough that I am trusting. And God has a time, a perfect timing for everything. And it tells us in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son. Right on time, right when the world needed it the most, Jesus Christ came into the world and revealed the glory of God, the glory of God's character, and he showed us what the kingdom of God is like in the Sermon on the Mount. He said the most shocking things a religious teacher has ever said. No man ever spoke like this man. He told people that except your righteousness become greater than the righteousness of your religious leaders, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. In other words, hypocrisy and a pretense and a big show is not enough. He said meekness and humbleness is a requirement. Loving your neighbor and poverty of spirit, humility,